defined by a cove in the southwest corner of West Seattle, this pocket community is one of the most stable neighborhoods in the city. Fauntleroy is well known for its beauty and bucolic character, home to acres of natural parkland, sweeping vistas of Puget Sound, one of Seattle's well-known ferries, and charming early 20th century houses and bungalows. Fauntleroy also has a large number of residents who have lived in the area for generations, including descendants of some of the neighborhood's founders. The longtime residents, joined by those who've moved to the area more recently, share a profound loyalty to the neighborhood. Fauntleroy established its identity over 100 years ago, when what was a remote, heavily wooded area began to become a community. This identity is just as strong among community members today. Fauntleroy Cove has a rich history, dating back to native tribes who used the cove as a summer fishing camp. The cove was first charted in 1841, and several years later, Lieutenant George Davidson, who was on a survey mission, named the cove Fauntleroy, after Eleanor Fauntleroy, his fiancée back in Indiana. The first settlement began to emerge as one of the early landowners, a Scottish immigrant by the name of James Murray Coleman, encouraged friends to build summer homes in the cove, laying the foundation of what was to become a thriving community.
My great-grandfather was James Murray Coleman, and he came here in 1861 or thereabouts. And he was a shipwright, or a millwright, I guess you'd call him. People who he worked for frequently didn't have the money to pay him. So they ended up paying him in land, and so he became a landowner. They had a group of churchgoers from Plymouth Church. They would come out and camp down here on the beach, and they all liked it out here. So a number of them kind of bought property from my grandfather, and then built summer homes. Or Camp Coleman was a family homestead down in Horsehead Bay, and so he was very interested in giving the boys an opportunity. At that point, it was only boys, and they were paper boys specifically, give them an opportunity to get some outdoor activity too. So if they had a perfect attendance at Sunday school, he would take them to camp during the summer. And I think initially they would ride down in his boat, the Osprey, and get down to camp, spend a week, and then come back. And that was the highlight of their summer. So when the Y became more active several years later, the Y took over that role of providing the kids. In fact, when they went to camp in the summer, most of the counselors were parents of the children in the community. The Camp Coleman is still going. In fact, we're coming up on a 100th year celebration in 2012.
As far back as 1912, members of the developing Fauntleroy community and other leaders in West Seattle recognized the benefit of preserving a portion of the area's natural beachfront and woodlands. The city began negotiations to purchase 130 acres just north of the cove, and 11 years later, Lincoln Park became a reality. Lincoln Park is the location of another area landmark, Coleman Pool, one of the few heated saltwater pools in the nation. Dedicated by the Coleman family in 1941, Coleman Pool replaced an even more distinctive facility known to locals as the Tide Pool or Lagoon Pool. In the mid-1920s, 200 feet of tidal swamp was scooped out by men and teams of horses, creating a basin, which was then filled by tide water from the Sound. Another of Fauntleroy's community elders worked at the old Tide Pool as a lifeguard and recalls its unique operation.
And when it was high tide, we had a big gate valve, and an inlet pipe about that big, and this gate valve just pulls up so the water will come through. And the tide would come in, it would fill the pool. Then we close the gate. And then the first day, there's hardly anybody there. It was cold water. The second day, it was more people. Third day, it was more people. The fourth day, I could walk across on the heads.
From these earliest days, youth were indoctrinated into a sense of stewardship for their environment and encouraged to take part in caring for the area's natural resources.
So then we opened that huge gate valve with a wheel like this, and the tide would go out and the water would rush out. While the pool was empty, all the little kids, they called them the polywogs. To get a polywog badge, you had to help clean the pool after they emptied it, because there's all kinds of stuff in there, you know. So we had these rakes, we had about 12 rakes and a bucket. And then we also taught them to take care of the little fish. A lot of, there'd be little pools in the bottom that would hold the water, and there'd be minnows in there, and candlefish, minnows, and oh, little baby crabs, all kinds of things that came in with the tide. And they, the kids, they got a point or so for their polywog badge if they picked up so many of those and put them and then took them out to the water. It was pretty good, really. They learned a lot. I've had guys come and tell me afterwards that they learned about taking care of nature that in that way.
Put the cup way down like that and then drop them in the water and you'll see them go scurrying off.
Today, the children and youth of Fauntleroy continue the legacy of environmental awareness. Dozens of youth groups from throughout West Seattle visit Fauntleroy Creek in the spring to release salmon fry. Mature salmon return to spawn in the fall, swimming up the newly constructed fish ladder from Puget Sound. Neighbors take great pride in the ancient cycle of returning salmon, which has only recently been restored. For decades, the creek had been neglected, merely carrying contaminated water from the hillsides into the Sound. In 1989, a group of concerned citizens came to the creek's defense.
We developed some sensitivity to the creek and some idea that perhaps we weren't doing the right thing. We were, again, treating it like a ditch, not a natural resource. I called up Metro, which was then responsible, and said, I would like to pay some attention to Fauntleroy Creek. Could we talk? And so began a partnership that continues quite productively to today. We are almost finished restoring the creek. We have one more little piece to do, probably in the summer of 2009.